And let's get into it. So I've come here today to talk to all of you about race, power, and the environment. And I want to start off with a picture of my mom. If you all saw my TEDx talk, I start with a picture of my grandmother. And I think it's really important that we honor where we come from. And so I wanted to start with a picture of my mom. I grew up in a single-parent, female-headed household, headed by the most beautiful, loving, caring, nurturing woman in the world. And we were poor. And we got a lot poorer when my mom got lupus. And she was forced to retire early. And so the only way that we were able to make ends meet, the only way that we were able to struggle and survive, was really to get connected to food, finances, cars, houses, through friends, family, social network, and word of mouth. And I start here, and I want to be really clear about what I'm saying. I'm saying that black people, poor people, and people of color, we invented the sharing economy, right? We invented it. But when the sharing economy gets commercialized, when the sharing economy gets commodified, when it gets corporatized, it always rolls out in the same way, right? And that is, we all know that where the ghetto and the barrio and the favela begin is where bike share and car share and greenways and green space tends to end, right? And so, next slide. If we really want to create these greentopias that everybody is talking about for our most marginalized communities, then we have to start asking different questions. We can't ask, next slide, how can we build, it's not enough to ask how can we build healthier cities, how can we build happier cities, how can we build greener cities. We first have to address real structural inequalities and the three most pressing issues of our lifetime, which are climate change, income inequality, and race, gender, immigration, and other forms of social inequality. Next slide. So the challenge of the 21st century then is how do we reimagine and redesign our cities for communities that have been locked out of shareable city conversations, locked out of sustainability conversations, locked out of smart cities conversations, and locked out of social justice conversations. How do we redesign our cities, not for, but with communities that are experiencing unimaginable forms of social and environmental trauma? Next slide. Have limited access to food and unprecedented, and are facing unprecedented environmental threats. Now, with just a 1 degree Celsius in terms of the rise of temperatures, we've seen what's happened in terms of Hurricane Katrina, Superstorm Sandy, Hurricane Joaquin, the most recent one was Hurricane Patricia, or some call it Patricia. We've seen the floods that have been happening. We know the Russian drought displaced 20 million people, right? And had the highest spike in prices, food prices we've ever seen. Next slide. So I call this eco-apartheid. And I start with eco, next slide. Eco-apartheid is a systems theory that examines the ecological impacts of structural racialization. And it highlights the ways that structures and institutions cumulatively cause unequal environmental health benefits and burdens based on race, class, gender, language, and their interconnection. Next slide. So what do I mean by eco-apartheid? So imagine, this won't be hard for some of you, but imagine that you all are dark-skinned youth growing up in West Oakland, right? So how many liquor stores are there in West Oakland?
Right.
So depending on how you draw the boundaries of West Oakland, right? You've got about 50 liquor stores in our community, right? Eco-imagination, we're all dark-skinned, black and brown youth, right? Now, how many grocery stores are in our community?
Maybe
one, right? Depending, I mean, you've got the people's grocery, right? And pack and save if you want. So, you know, one to two, depending on how you draw the boundaries of our community, right? So remember, we're talking about eco-apartheid, and we're talking about cumulative causation, right? And so now we're on our way to school, and we have to stop and eat. Where are we going to stop and eat? Liquor store. And what kind of food is available
Chips.
To us in the liquor store? Chips and Cheetos and donuts, right? And all that kind of stuff, right? Remember, we're talking about eco-apartheid. So now we're on our way to school, and we just loaded up with some food. And good thing, what is the race in the class of folks who are teaching us in urban schools?
White.
White, what's the gender?
Male. Oh, some, no, female.
White women. Right? In urban schools, the dominant folks who are teaching in urban schools are white women. Now, that does not mean that white women cannot teach us black and brown children. Right? We know that teaching, and Jeff Andrade does a great job of this in his research, teaching is about passion, it's about dedication, it's about preparation, it's about duty, it's about love. Right? But it is to say that none of those teachers look the way that we do. Right? Most of them. Right? So when we walk into that classroom, what is the general diagnosis for us black and brown children? We walk in and we're all sugared up, right? From what we just did. What's the general diagnosis for us black and brown children?
ADHD.
There you go.
Really?
Right? Right? That's right, right? So you can see that's what I mean by cumulative causation. Right? That's what I mean by eco-apartheid. In an eco-apartheid analysis, the outcome matters more than the intent. No one meant to do us any harm, right? But by the neighborhood that we live in, we're all on, what's the drug?
Ritalin,
right? They're giving us Ritalin, right? They're giving us all these drugs, right? That has nothing to do with us, right?
True.
This is truth, right? Being spoken. That is what I mean by this term of eco-apartheid. Now, next slide. Why is this important? Next slide. So, eco-apartheid is important for three reasons. One, it suggests that environmental bads, like toxic waste, are in low-income communities and communities of color. While environmental goods, like whole foods, open space, parks, are in wealthier neighborhoods. Is that true or not? That's absolutely true. Next slide. Next, eco-apartheid is a more powerful definition than environmental racism. So I'm hoping that you leave here today really empowered by this term eco-apartheid. And it's more powerful because it captures inequalities beyond race. And I'm talking about space, place, and waste, the transportation gap, the urban grocery gap, the fresh produce gap, while simultaneously centering race and racism and their implications. Next slide. Third, eco-apartheid captures the racial and spatial dimensions and reproductions of inequality. Right? And this is in the words of Tim Wise. What I mean by this is the history of the United States is the history of systematic, institutionalized racial privilege for white people and white-looking people. That's really important, right? Because when you first just say white people start to slump in their chairs and feel guilty. This isn't trying to guilt white people out, right? It's actually trying to have an honest conversation about how our country got to be the way it is and how our cities started to look the way that they do and our communities and neighborhoods look the way that they do, right? So the history of the United States is the history of systematic, institutionalized racial privilege for white people and white-looking people. And who knows what passing is? Passing. when you had to pass mixed. It doesn't just mean mixed, because you all can be mixed.
When you speak, or when you carry yourself?
It is kind of about mixing, but passing was something that black folks, brown folks, yellow folks, right? Everybody had to do it, not because we weren't proud of who we are, right? But to get access to institutional resources and privileges, right? So there would be like a brown bag test. If you could get in, right? If you were light enough, you could get in, right? You could get access to certain institutional resources and privileges, right? So, and we have racism in our own community and colorism in our own communities, right? So that's another thing when we really get real about these issues that we need to be talking about, right? And really unapologetically loving our deep, dark black skin, right? Unapologetically black, right? Unapologetically brown, right? And making sure that we expand that across our families, right? And the history of the United States hasn't done that, right? It's been that systematic institutionalized racial privilege for white folks and white-looking folks, whether we're talking about the naturalization law of 1790, the first law passed by Congress after the Constitution was ratified, which said that whites and whites only could be free citizens of the United States, or whether we're talking about the Homestead Act of 1862, which guaranteed white folks 160 acres of land. You know how much land that is? I don't even know how much land that is. I mean, right? It's just a lot of land for 10 bucks. And black people and people of color all over the world, we couldn't get 40 acres and a mule, right? Or whether we're talking about federally subsidized, federally underwritten FHA and VHA loans, on the backs of those loans was the creation of the white middle class. And if you would have done the same thing, when you do that same thing for black folks and people of color, you call it welfare. And when you do it for white folks, you know what you call it? Good, sound economic policy. Right? Am I right? And so, because of the systematic institutionalized racial privilege, the average white family has 20 times the average net worth of the average black family, right? 20 times, 18 times that of the average Latino family, right? This is key. Not solely because of hard work, right? Not solely because folks have better values, not solely because folks are more qualified. These are all the reasons that people are giving us, right? That they're getting the jobs, that they're getting into these schools, that they're more qualified, right? They work hard, right? That's not what's solely going on, right? And in fact, even my own grandmother, my grandmother is 95 years old, right? When she lives in Portland, Oregon, came from Louisiana, went to Portland, Oregon. My grandfather was a Pullman porter on that side of my family. My father's side of the family is from Ghana, West Africa. On my mother's side of the family, my grandmother earned enough money to buy a home. But could she buy a home in liberal Portland? No. Right? So this is part of the stories about how we can work together. Right? If it wasn't for a well-meaning white person helping her, right, she could have never even bought the home. Now, she worked hard enough to do it. My grandfather worked hard enough to do it, but they couldn't do it because the oppression was working on two levels, right? A racial level and a gender level, right? In terms of holding women back from being able to buy and have upward mobility, right? So what I want to really drive home here is the fact that the history of America and the way that people have gotten ahead has been the single greatest way of having upward mobility is by home ownership. And by being able to pass that house from one generation to the next, right? And we folks, many of us, have been systematically denied that. And the impact is not just about wealth, but it's also about health, right? It impacts our life expectancy, which I'm going to show you in a minute. It impacts where we go to school in terms of healthy schools and sick schools. We're talking about complete regions that are winner regions and loser regions in terms of access to open space parks, the kind of resources that allow us to really thrive. Next slide. So we have not correctly identified the problem. Most of the time we think of this problem, we talk about it as an achievement gap, right? An achievement gap implies inequalities based on cultural or gender difference. And we don't have an achievement gap, right? What we have is an opportunity gap, right? An opportunity gap remaps inequalities onto existing structural conditions. And if we see it as an opportunity gap, then we have to ask ourselves, what happens to those people who do not get it? The United States has 5% of the world's population, but 20% of the world's prisoners. One out of every four people locked up, and five people locked up everywhere in the world is locked up in a United States prison or jail, right? And this is what it shows for young black males who are more likely to be in the criminal justice system than we are in higher education, right? On the far left, what you see is the number of black males locked up, right, in the CDC. In the next bar graph shows you the number of black males in the UC system. Not just like UC Berkeley, right, California Department of Corrections. Not just UC Berkeley, but the whole UC system, right, 1,606. The next is the number of black males in the CSU system, right, 4,187. Mind you, the CSU system is the largest educational system in the world, right, in the world, when you add it all together. So there are more black males locked up in the UCCSU system, or in the locked up than in the UCCSU system combined. Right? This is a crisis, right, that we all need to respond to. Next slide. So Baltimore is burning, and I'm going to talk about what happened with Missouri, which I think is learning through Ferguson and through what happened and is happening with the concerned students of 1950. But really because of these structural inequalities, the lack of access to jobs, to parks, to open space, to good food, as well as the way that young black males and women and people of color in general are perceived by the police. Right? Racial profiling is rampant, right? And it's only gotten worse. Next slide. And so what happens to those of us who do get in, right? Who get an undergraduate degree from UC Berkeley, who have a graduate degree from Stanford University, and a PhD from an Ivy League institution? How do we fare? Do we do any better? So who's that?
You.
That is me. And do I look happy?
No.
No, I'm pissed off, right? Why am I so upset? Because one, it's 3:47 a.m. and I'm incarcerated and my civil rights have been unjustly violated. And anybody who does a cursory Google search of me will see this come up, right? And my story is one that resonates for many people probably in this room and beyond this room, right? Where at this time, I'm a single dad. I got a child, 5-year-old daughter and a 7-year-old daughter. And I live in Berkeley and I wanna go to San Francisco State to pick up some books to prepare for class. So I take my two children and I put them in the car, and it's about 9:30, 10-ish at night, and we drive across the Bay Bridge, and as we go across the bridge, my two children fall asleep. So we get to the campus and I park right next to my building, and I'm in a dilemma situation where I'm like, do I want to wake them up? Took them a long time to get into this power sleep, or am I going to just run in there and grab these books and come out? So I had never left my children before, but I said, I'm going to run in there and come out, and it should take me a minute, max. So I go zooming in, and this time I see a security guard at the door, and didn't think twice about it. Go upstairs, gather my books, come out of there, and I'm carrying my books, and a police officer is walking down the hall. Young, 22-year-old, white man. And he says, put your hands behind your back. Now, mind you, I'm about this far from my office where it says Dr. Antuia Combs' office, right? And I said, and I'm not sure I would say that now, but this is what I said then, which seemed really logical, why? Right? And he said, put your hands behind your back. I'm going to make you put your hands behind your back. And he knocks the books out of my hand. Then he drops to his knees, and he starts trying to wrestle me to the ground. Now, I'm looking at him like, what are you doing? Right? And I'm sort of holding on to him, trying not to fall down. And I said, stop. Stop. And there's people from me to about the end of this room watching this. And I looked at them, and I said, help. Right? And he calls for backup. So two black cops now come running upstairs, right? And one of them takes out some mace, and I'm like, put the mace down, what's going on, right? And they're like, oh, we just want to talk to you, we just want to talk to you. And I'm like, go ahead and talk to me, I got to get to my car. My children are in the car, I have to go. They said, I just want to talk to you. I said, okay, do what you need to do. So they said, all right, let us handcuff you. And once we handcuff you, we're going to take you downstairs, ask you a few questions, and then we're going to let you go. So do what you need to do. I need to get to my kids. So they handcuffed me and put me in the police car. Right? And so they didn't take me. They didn't ask me any questions. Right? And they said, you are going to be able to make one phone call. And if that person doesn't answer, we're going to take your children away to Child and Protective Services. Right? Now, what I need for all of you to go into your own imaginations at this point. Okay? Because what I was feeling at that time, I've never felt before in my life. Right? And it reminded me of how people really feel when you are enslaved. And now I want you to think about really being enslaved. And I want you to think about your mama being sold. Right? Your brother, your sister, your cousin. And there's nothing you can do about it. Right? That mixture of emotion that you're feeling when you're handcuffed and shackled and you can't move. Right? It's a lot of different emotions going on. Right? When that's going down. And happening to you, right? And I think it's really important for us to understand just what black folks and other folks have endured, the kind of pain and things that we've overcome, right? So I call my friend, he comes, they take me to jail, and once I'm in jail, I'm breaking bread with other folks who are in jail. What are you in here for? How'd you get in here? Blah, 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 right? I could not believe how many brilliant people were locked up. Brilliant. Brilliant people incarcerated for petty, petty stuff. Didn't have a driver's license, too many parking tickets. I mean, like, and you're locked up? Like, there's gotta be a better, more restorative justice way of dealing with incarceration. So my university responds in this really bizarre way, and this is pre-Black Lives Matter, right? Because I think if Black Lives Matters had happened, this would be like textbook case A, right up there with many of the other cases, right? But this is 2005, this is pre-Black Lives Matters, right? And so my university responds by banning me from campus. And thinking that I'm going to sue them and takes this really aggressive posturing of like, I've done something wrong. And the students rally in my defense, right? And really amazing stories of people power and the kind of difference that all of us can make, because this talk is about race, power, and the environment, but it's really a talk about movement building, right? At the same time, I had some really amazing support. The lawyer, white male, named John Kecker, who was the lawyer who cross-examined Oliver North in the Iran-Contra affair, was like, Antwi, I got your back. I'm gonna give you my legal services for free, and we're gonna fight these people. But even with his support, they kept pressing, and it wasn't until another very wealthy family, billionaires, right, as wealthy as the entire CSU system, perhaps wealthier, stepped in and said, we got your back, that the university backed out. Right? My children ultimately were fine, they went home and were fine, but the kinds of pain here that we all in this room know really well are psychological, right? Our mental health, like it's those invisible scars that you carry with you, right? Next slide. So after that event happened to me, I went from being sort of the poster boy, poster man for the incarcerated professor, and then Henry Louis Gates was a professor at Harvard, and he had a run-in with the police. So then I went to being the national expert on racial profiling. And this is me on the PBS Jim Lehrer NewsHour, sort of talking about the Professor Gates' case, and he met with President Obama, et cetera, et cetera. Next slide. And my point to all of you is that race matters. It matters in terms of racial disparities in the criminal justice system. But many of the same people who will protest about racial profiling in the criminal justice system will practice racial profiling in their classroom. I mean, well-meaning teachers, right? They'll be out there marching with you. And at the same time, will unconsciously be discriminating against the students of color or the women in their own classrooms, right? So the racial disparities are clear in criminal justice, but they're also, as you know, in education, they're in our healthcare system, they're in our housing system. They are in the structural shape of our cities and in our personal experience. Next slide. And, perhaps most importantly, is implicit bias. And implicit bias is that real, invisible killer. It's an implicit bias is about how we make unconscious stereotypes of other people. Right? And this is really the key. How we're raised, what are our cultural norms, what is the media feeding us, and implicit bias is so powerful that not only are people of color in general perceived as greater threats, but in video game simulations, police officers are more likely to shoot at people of color because of that implicit bias and the perception that we are threats. And within 5 seconds of an interview, folks have already made up their mind about your intelligence, your ability to really get that job and do that job well. Those are all the ways that implicit bias functions. And finally, it leads to low-income communities and communities of color being over-policed, right? In terms of coming into our communities for petty crimes and under-policed when we really need your help, right? We could wait around forever and nobody would show up. And what these things are doing to us is they have an impact on our body. Right. So what you see on the left-hand side, and the medical research is absolutely clear, that weathering is the negative physiological impacts of living in a race-conscious society. What you see on the left-hand side is a healthy vein. On the right-hand side is the vein of a person who's living in a race-conscious society who is stressed out. And that's cortisol in the vein. And isn't it funny that every time I show this, I just got this off the internet, but that right-hand side looks like Africa, doesn't it? And those, I mean, that's just ironic, right? But those happen to be the populations that are most impacted. Next slide. Next slide, let's do it for that. And what this amounts to is a life expectancy gap. Right? So if you live in the Oakland Hills, you will live 10 times longer than if you lived in the Oakland Flatlands. And what's really interesting about this slide is the Latino population. Because what it says is that the first generation Latinos and Latinas are actually living longer than the second generation. Right? That doesn't hold true for any other group, right? The first generation is doing better. The longer you stay, the worse you get. Why is that? Assimilation? That's right. Yeah, but it's good to say losing your culture. Any other guesses? I mean, that's it. I mean, it's really about assimilation. Next slide. And cultural protective factors, right? The more we love who we are, that serves as a protective factor against racism, right? So when a first generation person comes over, a really racist incident might happen. They don't even, one, might not even perceive it as racism. They might just be like, oh, they're just ignoring me, right? So it's not stressing them out. It's not having that internal effect in the body, right? Whereas those of us who have been here for a while are like, hey, they're ignoring me. They're following me around the store. They're crossing the street when I'm walking. They're, right? And another person might not be aware of those things. The other thing is that our diet changes over time. So, race subsumes social class. There's racism in the heart of liberalism. We racially profile whole communities. And gentrification is just another term for ethnic cleansing. Right? Next slide. So, next slide. Next slide. So what can be done? Next slide. What if we build a movement? And I said I came here to talk about movement building. So what if we build a movement at the intersections of social justice and the ecology movements, of entrepreneurship and activism, of interchange and social change? What if we didn't just have hybrid cars? What if we had a hybrid social movement? Next slide. And in order to get there, what I'm really talking about is what does it mean to revolutionize activism in the 21st century? We saw the power of what social media could do when we saw the revolution happen in Egypt, right? Next slide. We saw the ability of social media to mobilize people, to disseminate information, to garner international support, to organize people in ways that they could never organize before. Next slide. And how can we really use social media and digital organizing and these kinds of tools to movement build right here in the United States right now? Next slide. And in order to get there, we have to recognize how important this battle is. Like, our democracy has been hacked. It's totally controlled by big money and special interest groups. Right? They're dominating the discourse. Next slide. And technology is one way for all of us to reclaim our democracy, right? Through blogs, through Twitter, through posts. TV can't do it because TV alone is controlled by big money and special interest groups. So it has to be the internet. It has to be, the internet is almost like the printing press in the sense that it totally gives people who didn't have a voice and a say in what's happening in their communities. And it's a way to put the power back in the hands of everyday people. So I'm gonna give you an example of Morgan Dixon and Girl Trek, who's leading a movement, and she used social media as a part of it just to make this video around Black women to lead healthier lives.
Good morning, my name is Morgan Dixon. I'm out for my morning walk. I'm a part of an organization called Girl Trek that has rallied and mobilized 10,000 Black women and girls to take a step out and to walk for their health. Together across the country, from our communities, out of the front door, we walk 5 days a week, 30 minutes a day. for 8 weeks straight to reach, restart, jumpstart, kickstart healthier lives and to combat these statistics that say we're going to die earlier, younger, at higher rates than any other group in the country. 4 out of 5 of us are over a healthy weight. All of this is preventable. We know that walking changes things. When Black women walk together, it has always changed things. When women in Montgomery walked, it changed. When Harriet Tubman walked, it changed. And when we walk, things will change. I look forward to telling you more about this incredible organization. 10,000 women are on the streets now from places like Chattanooga to Detroit, and we are walking it out for our health. Look forward to talking to you more.
Can you guys give Morgan a hand? Morgan is doing really amazing work, and so I really encourage you all to follow her and support her work. Next slide. And what about what's happening at the University of Missouri? Next slide. You know, we know concerned students of 1950. Y'all are familiar with this, right?
No.
No. Got it. Okay. All right, so we all know what went down in Ferguson, right, with Michael Brown. So at the University of Missouri, what happened is in September, all of these racial incidents started to happen. And some white folks were walking around and they would yell the N-word out at Black folks, right? And one of those Black males, in this case, Jonathan Butler, said, "I've had enough, I'm going on a hunger strike." Okay? "And I'm going on a hunger strike until the president of the university resigns." Right? Bold statement. Then the Missouri football team came out, and this is the power of sticking together, and said, "We stand with Jonathan Butler. And we're not playing football on Saturday, right, until the president of the university resigns." Now, this is powerful because you know how big money, how much money there is in football, right? There's tens of millions of dollars of revenue that are made and lost. Perhaps more, I mean hundreds of millions, really, if they miss that football game on Saturday. All the other students, many other students came out, many other faculty came out, right? And this, if you look at hashtag concerned students of 1950, you all can track this yourself, right? But they use Twitter and social media to share their ideas, to connect with like-minded folks, and to lower the barrier so that we could all participate in this movement, and it wasn't something that was just local. It was something that was national and international, and we could all support that movement. Excellent. And so they won. Just yesterday, not only did the president of Missouri system resign, but so did the chancellor. Right? Now, can you imagine if we had that kind of unity, right, here, if we demonstrate that kind of resistance and agency and political contestation? Right, to the things that we don't agree with, and we stand in solidarity, this is a very important moment because it's showing the power of everyday people to transform their social material conditions on their school campus. So this should really be resonating with everybody in this room. Next slide. And they build off of a radical lineage of this, which Merritt College also has, which is connected to the Black Panther Party and their breakfast program, and how they knew that breakfast was related to cognitive development and how well you would do in school. Next slide. The South Central Farmers in South LA, who in the middle of this concrete jungle had 14 acres of urban farms to combat food apartheid, and growing culturally appropriate foods is really important to their story. Next slide. And so what about Oakland? What's going on in Oakland? Next slide. So like many of you, the three of us and many other people have created this research institute called ICE, right? And just like many of you, 30 million folks, ICE is located right in the heart of a food desert, filled up with liquor stores, fast food, abandoned buildings, and toxic air, where there's more drive-throughs, right, then drive-bys, and every day people are dying of curable diseases in our neighborhood. Next slide. And you all are familiar with the disparities between Oakland and Piedmont, right? But it's really important when you see it, visualize, right, that we have 5 times the obesity rate than folks do living in Piedmont, and we're not even a mile away, right? That's the resource gap. That's the opportunity gap, next slide, that I'm talking about. And so a group of us, some of us had PhDs, some of us had master's students, some of us are formerly incarcerated, many of us had no degree at all, right? What we shared in common was just being sick and tired of watching people die in our communities of curable diseases, right? People popping ventilators like they're popping Hershey candies, with dialysis stores popping up on the corner like Starbucks, right? Next slide after this. So at IC, we started to build game-changing tools for communities to innovate, cities to become smarter, communities to collaborate. Next slide. And what we want to talk to you all about is a really powerful tool called Streetwise. So Streetwise is a digital organizing platform that allows folks, it's a mobile mapping and SMS platform that gives real-time information about cities and services. And what's really important about that is right now the kind of information that you get is from a GIS map that'll tell you, oh, you might live near a park. But what's really important is your experience in that park, right? It's not just knowing you live near the park, it's your experience in the park. Is that the park where the drugs are sold? Is it safe enough to bring my children to the park? Right? Do the swing sets work at the park? You need something in our hands that can give us both our proximity to something and our experience with something as we navigate a community. And so Streetwise answers questions that other platforms can't, like how walkable is my neighborhood? We all know the walkability varies from block to block. If you're a single woman and you're walking home late at night, you might want to know, where is those blocks where women are being sexually harassed the most? Where is the block where the most lighting is, right? So how walkable is my neighborhood? How well is it served by public transit? How safe is this street? Where can I buy fresh, affordable food, a good doctor? Questions, real-time questions like that. Next slide. And part of what the platform does is it puts the power back in the hands of everyday people to make public data sets more accurate. So what you're seeing here is a data set from the Alameda County Department of Public Health. Supposedly, this is the number of grocery stores that there are in East Oakland, according to the Alameda County Department of Public Health. So if you're looking in East Oakland from a policymaker view or from their view, it looks like it's a food oasis. Right, but when you use Streetwise, what you find out is that instead of those being grocery stores, they're liquor stores, as we've just gone through, right, once you ground truth that data. And then the platform, again, allows people to tell their own stories and use the social media so people can articulate what are the real conditions happening to me on the ground level. And this is a video of a young woman talking about narrating grocery stores in her neighborhood.
Okay, so
it was dirty when I went inside, and I would never eat anything in there.
Do you consider this to be a grocery store?
Hell no.
Why?
Because they don't sell any groceries, and it's just a bunch of junk food in there. And I mean, they have little sandwiches, but I would never eat that because it's dirty. And then all the fruit is all like old, like wrinkly and looks old. And then all the like meat that they did have, like the bacon and all that in the little thing, looks like it's been sitting in there for about a year or something like that. I wouldn't call it a grocery store at all. So, hell no.
Right, question. Yes. You all know where that one is?
Yes.
Yeah, that's right. Right outside of Utah Process. Next slide. So we've used this platform in San Diego. They found arsenic in the water, and the successful policy win was to argue for more safer drinking water fountains. In Merced, We identified a spatial mismatch between where the jobs are and where low-income folks live and where the buses are running, so we were able to successfully argue for better bus stops, right? And in East Oakland, you just saw us talk about what was happening with food deserts. And we're gonna be launching Streetwise across 12 cities in the US next year, and we are a platform provider for something called 100 Resilient Cities. So we're gonna be launching globally. And we want everybody in this room to think about joining our private beta of Streetwise as we launch this tool publicly in 2016. Our success in 2012, you all might know that out of this kind of work, Oakland, this was one of the factors that helped Oakland argue for a new central kitchen and education center, right, and a 1.5 acre campus farm. Next slide. There was a farmer's market that was put in right in front of Castlemont that did not exist before, and it's really important to see that this work is leading to results. This organizing is leading to action, right? Next slide. They say that they've put $475 million into improving school facilities, but that's been a slow process. But this is a win that they're claiming. Next slide. Next slide. And so overall, this is me teaching students. I teach high school students, and they get San Francisco State credit for the class, right? And we actually do a reverse creaming, where we're actually looking for students that aren't doing so great, right? And we want to offer our class to them rather than only offering advanced placement classes to kids who have a lot of resources. And this is us. We did a climate justice youth bill of rights. This is our first youth bill of rights, and this is a group of kids that we took to the Black and Latino Congressional Caucus in Washington, D.C. And more recently, we want to move towards doing a much larger youth bill of rights. I think the power of the work in Missouri is great, but it can't end there. So the idea is, how do you keep that work alive, right? How do you keep engaged in something that is not just about one and done activism, but it's about ongoing activism, right? And our way and method of doing that has been, let's have this larger conversation about a climate justice bill of rights that is not a dead document, but a living document that we can all update and talk about what's working, what's not working, and what needs to be improved. Next slide. Next slide. And so I'm gonna end with saying, you know, why can't we have schools with living walls, vertical walls of plant that filter air and help reduce the carbon footprint? Why can't we have schools where we put solar panels on the roofs and young people get paid for putting the solar panels on the roofs, right? Why can't we have greenhouses and edible gardens in our schools? Why shouldn't we be doing more of that kind of work? College and career pathways that have an academic component, a career technical education component, a work-based learning component, wraparound social services, and of course, racial justice and social equity running throughout. Next slide. And when I ask that, I want to say that we actually have started that school, right? And this is a school led by this man, and you need to watch his TED Talk. He's a professor at San Francisco State, and another woman at San Francisco State named Allison Titiago Kubalis, who started a school called Roses and Concrete in East Oakland, right? That is that school that we just talked about, and we just got approved and just opened this fall. So that was something really significant that IC is giving birth to, and we're happy to. We're happy to share more information about that. Next slide. And we finally want to just ask you all to join us in creating the next generation of rock star designers, architects, and urban planners, and social justice educators from low-income communities and communities of color, ushering a new age of renewable energy, right, and really reduce the carbon footprint, bottom-up innovation, make sustainability not just sexy, but embrace the ugly and dirty side of having to do the work, right? Everybody's always talking about being pretty and sexy and all these things, but it's actually a lot of hard work, and we need to embrace that work, right? Not just having low-income folks and communities of color be part of dinner conversations, but embracing us being part of the decision-making table, That means changing who's in leadership and who's in leadership positions and having people of color and women lead and designing communities for all people so people don't have to leave their communities in order to live, learn, work, and thrive. And if you were moved by this talk or motivated by it, next slide, please, if you haven't already, check out my own TEDx talk called Innovation Out of Poverty. TED has a nasty habit, I'm gonna unveil a dirty little secret, of not posting as many women and people of color as they should on their homepage, and or, even when they do, not making us the editor's pick, right? Which brings a lot of attention to the work. So tweet about this talk, share it, and do me a favor, do us a favor, at least share it with one friend, right? And have them share it, because the only way that this talk is gonna get out is through people power. And that's what we're all about. And so thank you for your time, and we're happy to take any questions.
First year here at Merritt. And so my question was, regarding to what happened in Missouri, do you think it was right to ask their dean and principal and chairman to step down, or do you think they should have took a different approach to that?
Yeah, I support what they did, but I think I get your larger point, which is that is not always the right thing to do, right? I need more information, you know, but from what I've read, they gave the president of the university several months to respond to the systemic racism that was happening on campus. And they had protests, they wrote letters, they tried to have open forums, and there was no response, right? And so I think I commend Jonathan Butler for going on the hunger strike and really pushing the envelope and putting, literally, I had a quote up there, but I wanted to keep it moving, but I mean, he was like, I will die for this cause, right? And I think at that point, yeah, you need to step down because somebody's life is on the line, right? And also, you have not been doing what you're supposed to do. Apparently when I read, like, the president had never been a president of a university before, right? And I think that there could be some issues with his own background where maybe he was not the best person to lead them into reaching their full potential as a university, particularly around diversity, equity, inclusion, racial justice, and social justice. And if he can't do those things are just as important as making any kind of money for the university, right? And in fact, they go hand in hand, right? And if you aren't equipped on that level, maybe you weren't the right hire, and you should step away. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Rosemary.
Hey, Rosemary.
My question is, as far as having a movement and the way the movement started in Missouri, the movements that we have here in the Bay Area are very different from that. And in my opinion, almost shine a negative light on what we're trying to do and our people just as much as a positive that we, you know, like that we try to shine on whatever the cause is. So how can we motivate or how can we move our protests and the way we want to shine a light on a certain cause to a more effective and peaceful and, I guess, respectful way, like what was done in Missouri, versus trashing our own city, basically.
Yeah, that's interesting. You know, I think we're being a little hard on the Bay Area You know, I think when you think of the legacy of the Bay Area, we've been, they're learning from us as much as we're learning from them, right? So even historically, everywhere from the Black Panthers to the protests at UC Berkeley to many of the protests, I mean, we walked in a lot of the Black Lives Matter protests, and many of those were peaceful. They weren't bad. Many of those protests that we were walking in were totally peaceful. I also think the Bay Area, we're fed up too. Like the Oscar Grant, like when you really look at the things that have been happening here, it wasn't just like, not even just, but it went beyond, hey, you call me the N-word, right? You keep killing us and destroying us. And the income inequality that I mentioned in the Bay Area is growing maybe faster than any other place in the country. And I think that that's creating a different kind of attention. And I think there's an opportunity there to have a different kind of movement. So I think we can learn from each other, and we need to learn from each other. But overall, I think I wouldn't put us all in the one bucket. You know, I think we've had some things go wrong, and I would, at some point, I'd love to hear from you. Maybe you're thinking about Occupy, you know. Occupy the freeway, yeah. And, you know, I think this really gets into strategy, really, right? And that is a great conversation, because it's about, you know, do we take over the ports? Do we do it in a Gandhi way? Do we do it in a nonviolent way, but we're blocking the ports, so you're gonna lose your $1 billion a day. We're gonna cut into your economic, right, in order to get our demands met. But we're gonna train in the practices of nonviolence, right? And I think the organizers haven't had enough of those strategy meetings to make sure that we have that one unified vision. And then a few apples, and sometimes they're planted, or sometimes they're just outsiders, right? Come in and they're like ready to throw down, when we've spent the whole time training all of us, and that one person comes in and just sets it off, right? And we have to just prepare ourselves for that too. So I think it's an excellent question. Thank you.
My name is Keita, and I just had a question about the school and Streetwise. So who exactly is piloting Streetwise?
I see our organization is piloting Streetwise, and Streetwise actually also has its own company that we gave birth to. IC gave birth to. So it's us right here. We're Streetwise,
okay.
Right? And you could be a part of it. And we're going to launch it in 12 cities starting in next year, in 2016. But then we're going to have a public launch, right, where we want everybody here to be walking around using the platform. We think it's a great platform to help folks navigate their neighborhoods, find goods and services, and report that real-time experience that you're having. And that real-time experience is what really leads to the digital organizing. Different ways of saying what's working in my community, what's not working in my community. You can crowdsource that information, and you can tell your own story, right? So that Detroit can talk to Oakland, Oakland can talk to New York can talk to DC. We can all be learning from each other. So we would love for you all to join the private beta. Did you want to comment on that, or did you want to comment? Go ahead. What's the private beta?
Oh, the private beta, we would just invite you to use the platform and post things that are happening in the community. So as we start rolling it out, you get access to it, but not the general public wouldn't get access. You would just get access, and the people who are in the private beta, and then as a part of the private beta, you give us feedback on what's working and how we can improve the platform.
We'd love for you.
I would
definitely do that. And another thing is, there's a school, the Rose Compton
just reach out to us and we'll connect you with Jeff and Allison. And we'll take it from there. And if they don't move swiftly enough, then keep me posted and we'll make it happen.
Oh, no worries. My name is Mai.
Hey, Mai.
Again, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet
so,
you.
I really enjoyed that quote that you had up there by Van Jones. I partook in the Hill of the Streets Fellowship, which is under, you know, the L. Baker Center or something that he founded. And my supervisors were really instrumental in incorporating participatory action research for us youth to kind of be interested in talking about the social justice issues that we face in our communities. As an organizer and activist, what other incentives have you found to work to gain the interest of those who are faced with these issues, who complain about these issues, but don't take any action to come about making solutions?
So how do we incentivize people to participate in their own liberation? Is that the question?
Yeah.
I think, so in my own TEDx talk, I talk about what I see as the problem, which is right now we have a profit over people model, right? Instead of a people over profit, right? And the profit over people model is an extraction model, right? And what we really need is the flow of capital needs to be an investment model. And my point is, I think you incentivize people when you are investing in people, when you're investing in communities, when they see that they can get something good for themselves, when you're making my life easier, when you're helping my community, right? I think, to me, and you know, we have a great test audience here, but those are things that get me excited. Like, I can help my family, I can help my friends, I can help my community, I can help myself, right? I think if it's not clear to me how I can do those things, I think you tend to not get a lot of investment, right? But ultimately, you can't legislate that kind of participation, right? You can inspire, right? You can be the change you want to see, you know. But there's no one way to legislate it, I think, or incentivize it. I think if we're talking about different things, like maybe affordable housing or certain things, you can incentivize some of these things, right? And get people excited to participate, right? So it also depends on what you're looking at in Heal the Streets. Some things you could incentivize, and I could think through it with you all, but other things you just can't. That's been my experience. Thank you. Final questions? Yes, sir.
My name is Phil. My question was, I actually love to be given the opportunity to do the students of making these work through Walmart and giving them the opportunity to actually put these solar panels on the roofs and actually give them, not necessarily give them money, but actually feed them as work.
Yeah.
My question is, come against the training of this, one thing I was thinking about with solar panels, you actually have to do, you have to thoroughly know electrical component, electrical circuit, how well you can possibly know. There are further instances that you're not using the energy, there's things that you have to teach to ship out. So basically, the same, are you going to be using any of this funding to actually teach these kids beforehand?
Yeah, can I jump in? I mean, the short answer is yes. So the question was, are we training young people to put solar panels on, for example, to put solar panels on the school? And the short answer is yeah. So the whole, when I went through building college and career pathways, and I talked about having a core academic component, a career technical education component, a work-based learning component, right, and wraparound support services, that whole idea is about building that college and career pathway. It's about building that pathway out of poverty, that pathway of prosperity that actually grew out of Van Jones's work, right? And continuing that Van Jones and Ella Baker Center did a great job of targeting folks generally 24 and up. They didn't necessarily focus on folks 17 to 24, right? The high school age students that we think is a highly employable population, right? So we've also been focusing on that population and supporting them in their work with others who are older. But thank you for the question. So thank you, everybody. Have a great time. Stay in touch. Make sure you stay in touch. Reach out to us. You have all of our contact information. Knowing your mentors right here, happy to mentor, connect you to resources, support you, kick ideas around, whatever, right? Use your resources, you know. And Tessa's our first point of contact. She gets back to everybody right away, but we're also right there for you, and we'll reach back.
T. Cruz.
T. Cruz. Yeah. All right, everybody, have a great day.